Buckle up, sports fanatics. This is the Sports Chasers Podcast, your HQ for in-depth sports talk. Join host Kevin L. Warren and crew as they dissect the hottest stories, ignite debates, and bring you closer to the action. From locker room whispers to expert takes, we cover it all. It's game time. So strap in and grab a drink. The Sports Chasers Podcast starts right now.
Hey, what's going on, everybody? What's happening, everybody? It's another edition of the Sports Chasers Podcast, man, coming to you. Well, we're not live, but hey, when you get this, it will be live. We're back again for part two, as we said, part two with our interview with Mr. Jason Medlock, who's our hypnotist and mindset performance coach, man. We had a great time hanging out with Jason last week, and we're here to do it again. So hopefully, if you watch part one, you're going to want to absolutely watch part two, because we could not absolutely cram none of that, all of that stuff, what Jason had to say on part one. But before we get to our special guests tonight, hey, DA, what's up, brother? How are you tonight, sir?
Salutations, brothers.
Sounding like Mike Mills over there, man.
Yeah,
the DA and Jason, they was kicking some knowledge off there. And I was like, I'm going to just let these gentlemen have at it, because they was going deeper than what I guess Jason was.
Jason might be on here. Like, we might have like a 15 minute weekly with Jason just to get cats' minds right.
You know,
in the rest of the world, because you know, you guys might need some words of the week. You know, every week, like, you know, because it's dead serious, man. It's dead serious.
Without further ado, and Jason is in Texas, so we've been talking about the mind and stuff like that, and without further ado, Jason Medlock. Jason, how are you tonight, sir? How's it going, bro?
I'm going well. I'm just glad to be back. And I know we covered a number of topics, DA and Kevin, but, you know, ready to get back in it. And I think we probably we were talking about anxiety, and we just didn't have enough time. We just didn't have enough. So but I'm glad to be here.
Yeah. Thank you so much for coming back. And like I said, man, I said it last week, man. This is really a great thing that I'm glad that we connected, and yeah, we're talking about sports, but the mind is something else, as it absolutely sets the tune for your day and for your life and energy. We was talking about energy, and we was also I wanted to talk to you a little bit, just a tiny little bit. You know, they had the eclipse today. You got probably a very good portion of that. How does that connect, that whole energy, the eclipse and all that stuff? Because, you know, I didn't see it down here in South Florida, not a lot, but just go ahead.
I was interviewing a woman by the name of Linda Horrig, and I have another podcast. I have a podcast, Mental Game Plan, focuses on mindset of athletes, coaches, you know, mental training. And I have another podcast. It's called Expansion of Consciousness, and this deals with more of your meditators, your healers, your psychic mediums, you know, people who really are gifted and can feel, they sense, they have intuitive abilities. So this lady named Linda Horrig, who's a world-renowned psychic medium, she was on last week, and she was talking about the solar eclipse. And I said, well, what's going to happen? Is it going to change our DNA? I mean, we're going to be different type of people. What's going to happen, Linda? She says, change? No, it's going to awaken parts of our DNA, this energy from the sun. She said, you have to remember, Jason, our DNA strands aren't all active. And there are parts of the DNA that scientists just can't figure out. She said, so this energy in some people will awaken different parts of your DNA, and you know, it will allow future generations to be a little different than the generation we're in. When you think about it, when you think about early man, caveman, and I think it was a hominidus, you know, as we evolved, those humans back then are nothing like we are right now. And I know DA knows what I'm talking about. You know what I mean? It's almost like we were just dropped off on the earth, or they brought this newer version of human and mixed him into the timeline of the human history. So she was just saying that, you know, this energy from the sun is more than likely activating portions of our DNA.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
And I think for people that are ready, like if you're positioned, like, so if you're already on the journey, it'll probably hit you quicker than folks that are, you know, just somewhere, you get hit by gamma rays, like, you know, you Bruce Banner and turn into the Hulk. But if you're already working towards something in your mind, I think, you know, your receptacles are more open to these things impacting you. You know,
and I'm sure Aaron Rodgers, he probably know as well.
Yeah. Depending on what he's doing today. But that's for sure. Real quick, Kev, what did want to say, regarding the person that Jason was talking to, like, and we said this a little bit before the show, but I'm just going to say this out loud. This is not all tinfoil stuff. Because medians and people like that, folks with those abilities, are federal. And, you know, we know our government wastes money and they do a lot of crazy things. But just know, there are officially on the books millions of dollars spent by our government, CIA, FBI, other agencies on mediums going back to the 1950s. Facts. So somebody believes that this stuff is real. Like, it's just not during in a tinfoil Yankees cap on, like, it's for real, like, because someone else is paying people to do this, to do research into this type of stuff. So, you know, when Jason says he's speaking to people about these topics, it's real to more than just a small segment of individuals. There are a lot of folks that believe in this because they spend a lot of money on it. So we're
gonna deep dive. Right, let's get back into it. So, Jason, in your book, chapter 2 discusses common mental barriers such as lack of motivation, focus issues, and confidence dips. What practical steps can athletes take to overcome these barriers? And could you share some examples of some of these people that who have successfully navigated these challenging waters?
Well, I mean, you know, when you are lack of focus and, you know, you have these mental blockages and barriers, you know, typically, we spoke about the last time on the show, there's an issue that's, you know, maybe childhood, or there's something going on, you know, deep in, you know, the construct in which you're living. You know, it could be the way that you're being raised. It could be the, you know, how you're being coached or the way, you know, you're being talked to. So people develop barriers, mental barriers. For example, you can have a money blockage, and some people's like, well, how do you have a money blockage? You can be told when you're a young person by your mom, you know, mom, I want those jeans. We don't have that money to get those jeans. We don't have this or we don't have that. And you kind of understand, and, you know, my mom is working. But when you get older, you have this blockage on, you know, how much you can pay for things and, you know, not having money. And that could stop you from being wealthy and stop you from being a fruitful person. But let's just move that right back to athletics with these athletes. When you notice that young men have these blockages, so to speak, you have to really get to the root problem. And that's the difference between sports psychology and sports hypnosis. Sports psychology is more mechanical, more surface, more, you know, figuring out, you know, when did the issue start? Let's talk about it, which is okay. And I said that the last time we spoke.
Right.
The reason why I use hypnosis is because I like to delve into the subconscious mind. And that's the technique. The technique is delving into the subconscious mind and moving the young man or the young woman into a different brainwave state. And once I can get them into a different brainwave state, I am able to ask the questions of them while they're in this deep theta somnambulistic state and try to figure out where are the blockages. And just like with any client or any person that you're seeing, Kevin, you want to then bring forth this issue. You know, if it is the yips, as they would call it in golf, where you just can't hit the ball and you're curving it, or if it is, you know, lack of focus when you're, you know, trying to shoot free throws. I mean, I know there are several instances in the NBA where guys just cannot shoot the free throws. You know, we don't know where the blockage is, but when you do find it, you address it, you bring it forth. And then from the way, you know, the techniques I use, I am trying to actually reprogram the subconscious mind using actual manifestation, using positive self-talk, reinforcing whatever it is I get from the intake. And that's the interview process that I do before I get these athletes in. Whatever it is, they're telling me I'm having problems with X, Y, Z. I'm taking that same information and moving it into a script, moving it into an induction. And this is when I'm talking to them while they're in a relaxed state. And I may start off by saying the basketball court is a peaceful place. It's a place where you enjoy, playing the game that you love. It's a relaxed state. Imagine yourself picking up the basketball and stretching at the same time. You know, tell me how that feels. Tell me what you're doing right now. You know, now you are moving into a place where there's peace and there's a lake and there's an ocean. So I'm moving them through this induction to really, really relax them, taking them on a visualization tour. And as I continue to talk to them, to continue to move them into a deeper state of consciousness, I already know exactly what the intake process was on the information I was receiving from them for the particular thought or particular thing they needed to work on. And now I've integrated this information into my script. And now, you know, I'm saying now you will think about when, you know, running the third base and you will slide with the right knee. You know, or you will have your elbows locked in when you're taking the free throw, but you will always remember to take a deep breath before you take the free throw. I will keep saying whatever the technical fundamental is that they're lacking, that will be repeated over and over as I try to induce a change in the subconscious mind at the subconscious level. So those are the techniques. And yeah, I do have an instance where I was working with a young man at the University of Utah. Actually, he was one of my my son's friends. And, you know, he was wanting to run faster. He was running to run, get into the 4.5s. He was in the 4.6s. But what I did was all the things that needed to happen for him to reduce the speed, that's what I focused on when I started to write the script. And when in the interview process and the intake process, it was working on the abs. It was strengthening his abs or core. It was strengthening the lower body. It was throwing the elbow back, throwing the elbow. So I integrated those subliminal messages into the script using sports hypnosis. And as I got him into these deep states of relaxation and took him on the visualization journey, then I started to make suggestions to the subconscious mind on exactly what needed to take place and, you know, how he was to perform. And you do this over and over and over until you get the change. And the young man started to actually work on the other things that he needed to work on in a resentless manner, in a fearless way, you know, not wavering, not doing the things that he's supposed to do. He was actually doing them, and he was doing them with intention.
Now you kind of unlocked them, as the kids say. You unlocked them.
I unlocked him from a subconscious level. And I didn't do self-talk. Nope. I used, mindset techniques and moving him to a relaxed state so that I can deal directly with his subconscious mind, which is a stark difference in sports psychology versus sports hypnosis. And adversity, Same thing. Resilience, same thing. You know, all of this, Kevin, involves doing the initial intake, okay, understanding the actual problem, then breaking the problem out and moving it into a scripted format so that you can actually input, change the software within the person. So those are the methods that I use to actually effect change.
So let me ask a question. Kev.
Go ahead.
But this kind of goes back to kind of where, so when we're talking about some of these blockages in sports and life, right? So because you started out talking about money, and this is something that we know, you know, growing up in the hood or whatever, that, you know, it may be a situation where your parents always, or your mother, and it's not a fault, right? No, it's not when anyone's being nefarious. They just say, man, we ain't got no money. We can't get that. Or we can't do this, right, and we can't do that. So we never grow up with the positive affirmations of saying, well, you know, as a man thinketh he is, you know, I will have this. Now, all because you say it doesn't mean it's going to happen. There are actions that have to take place for these things to happen. Which is, of course, going back to your scripts, because you're usually giving them, you know, all right, now this is the problem, as you stated. We're going to break down some barriers, and we'll get into the technical things that you need to do, and we'll keep, you know, talking through it and implanting things you already know, but just opening, you know, unlocking you so you can go do what you need to do. But I mean, sports, coaching, and life, how do we get the folks that are our mentors, our parents, our coaches to understand that one is, you know, it's not that you're just a hard-headed kid and you don't want to run fast or do whatever, that, you know, maybe there has to be some points where we can kind of, not say break down, but, you know, say, hey, man, what's the issue, you know, or know when it's time to jump in with some of your techniques. Because I'm sure as guys watch this and they're coaching, they're going to say, God, I don't even know when to start. Like, how to start? How do I know when? You know, because you as a coach, you took over for parents, Jason. So you had to know when, because you don't, you know, when the dad or mom lets their son out of the car to come to your practice, you know, and that kid's not acting right, you know, how as a coach do you approach this to where you can kind of help out, step in? Because I really want to start getting you out to some coaches that I know to say, listen, man, you guys need to talk to him, you know, because you may not have a kid like this today, but you may have a kid like this tomorrow, you know, that you can reach and help out, you know.
Well here's the thing. Anyone who is working with kids or anyone who is wanting to implement some of these strategies, the first thing is, and again, we talked about it, is about you have to set the intention to do it. You have to be willing to lose weight. You have to be willing to stop smoking cigarettes. You have to not look at this as, man, I mean, you know, just these kids are hard-headed. Well, then the paradigm that you're living in doesn't suggest that you are open to different alternatives to help the kids. So you have to be open to it in order to change. And that's the same thing for the athlete. If they're not open to sports psychology, if they're not open to hypnosis, and I don't care how many times if Kevin tells his son, man, you got to get with Jason, this is what you need, this is what you need. These kids have to be open to it. So I would say for the coaches, parents, what have you. And remember, I told you guys the last time, I told my sons, I missed it. I actually missed the mental part of it. I thought I was giving them the mental side of it and I was skill training, but I missed the real true mental side of it, is to teach them that anxiety and to teach them that stress was going to be there regardless, but that they was okay for them to realize it and recognize it. How are you going to deal with it? So, DA, they just have to open their minds to say, I want to try something different. When a person finally says enough is enough, when a person says to themselves, I will do this, or I'm going to learn this, that's the easy part. Now they allow me. Subconsciously, they allow me to start to work with them, to start to teach them new strategies. They're open to the fact that breathing techniques helps with anxiety. And if you teach it well before the issue happens, because even before a game, everybody has them, butterflies. We have them. And with that being said, a player can be off to the side, rah, rah, rah with the team, but quietly. He's getting himself, he's moving his heart rate down. He's moving everything to a normal pace. He's thinking. So he's using breathing techniques quietly or sitting in the bench in the locker room waiting for the game. Now, for his coaches, absolutely. If they buy in to the fact that I wouldn't mind putting another tool in the bag, and that's the only thing it takes, DA, is for a person to say, yes, I'm open to that. And, you know, these techniques, I mean, they are awesome. I mean, they will provide you with a number of things you can do with the student athlete and with the pro athlete in regards to helping them setting goals, helping them, you know, be mindful of themselves, helping them to understand gratitude. You know, a lot of these things sound holistic when they are holistic, but when you build a young man and offer him all these different things along with regimented training, it makes him that much more focused. It makes his clarity that much more clear. It makes him that much more coachable and the ability to retain information and sharper. So yeah. I would not discount any of these techniques if I was a coach, a dad, uncle who was stepping in for the dad, and a mom that's training maybe her daughter, or she's the only one in the house working with this hard-headed little boy, and in essence she can help him develop at a much faster level, much faster pace.
Sounds good.
Jason, yes, I'll say this. I was one of those persons. On a personal note, like I didn't believe in none of this breathing technique and stuff like that. And I had somebody kind of introduce me to this stuff, and I actually started utilizing it. And I can really attest it works. And yes. I wish somebody would have introduced this to me when I was the younger Kevin or whatever the case may be. But it's never too late. It's never too late. And I'll give you a personal testament today. I had to go get an MRI on my shoulder, and I don't like being closed in this stuff. And they was like, hey, do you want volume? I was like, man, I don't want to be on no drugs with none of that stuff. So I literally had to count and did some breathing, some stuff. And I was good. And I actually, and D8, when we can talk about this off the air, I actually teach a wellness class during my day gig. And we talk about a lot of breathing techniques and envisioning and that stuff works. And I am the most, and DA tell you, I'm the most skeptical person when it comes to a lot of things. But this, I truly, yeah. He's shaking his head because he's known me a good portion of my life. And yeah, this stuff works. So coaches, parents, you might need to get in touch with my man right here, Jason right here, because I truly, truly believe that this works along with, as we talked last week, we talked about sports psychology, right? And how with sports psychology and with hypnosis tagged to it, I think it, in my opinion, it would almost make like a super soldier, so to speak.
Absolutely. And you're bridging the gap between physical and mental, the physical aspect of training, of going to get worked on your shoulder, with the mental aspect, you know, mental fortitude. And, you know, it's another strategy. It's just another practical technique you can use to enhance yourself at the job, you know, to enhance your performance in sports, to enhance your relationship, you know, at home, you know. And it helps. And, you know, I used to think you develop mental toughness by training hard and watching a lot of film. And, you know, you better not be scared of anybody out there. But that's not how you develop mental toughness. Right. You know, you develop mental toughness by teaching mental strategies. You know, teaching a person how to use different methods to ward off anxiety, to look at stress and say, oh, okay, I see you right there. You're there. And it's to be expected. But I know how to handle you, and I know how to put you where I need you to be. In teaching a young man how to use positive self-talk, or having a coach understand what positive self-talk is and effectively communicate with his player. You know, and we need to not soften this thing up as if we want all the coaches to be fluff balls. No, we don't want you to be soft and fluffy. No. We want you to be very clear and direct and strong and tough. But we also want you to use techniques and be effective with these techniques so that the young man not only respects you as his coach, he respects you as a person that's really actually poured into his life and helped him develop.
Right. Makes sense. Makes sense. Because it's, like I said, this is just crazy because what you're showing right now is so far in a way bigger than just sports. Like everything you're saying touches on life, period, in general, for kids, parents, families, you know, communities, you know, and I think one of the strongest things you said, man, is, you know, hey, I see that there can be stressors and there are issues and I'm not running away. I just have a strategy, right? So it's not that you can knock down every wall because you can't knock down every wall. Some walls you got to run around, go over. You know, there are ways to avoid certain things. You breathe, you learn how to deal with them a certain way and you can get through it. And it's not necessarily the old, you know, run through a wall. Why, coach? I can just go around the walls. You know, I'll still score. I'm still going to score. It's fine, coach. I got it. Don't worry about it. But, yeah, it makes sense, man. Strategy is everything. You know, it's not that you're running away from anything. You're just attacking it differently.
And Kevin talked about, you know, he was just talking about, you know, mental barriers. You know, that man, just people face mental barrier, let alone athletes, but, you know, in emotions. We know that there are some emotional players in the NBA. Draymond Green is an emotional player, and it impacts his performance sometimes. You know, and just like Meta World Peace, he would say, hey, I don't care what nobody say, it's good to have somebody to talk to.
Yeah.
He was a huge proponent in talking to someone. So emotions, again, Kev, and mental barriers and things like that with athletes face, what are some actionable strategies? How do you help these guys? You know, and you know, if I'm a sports psychologist, I'm delving into a lot of self-talk. You know, what does that do to you when you are yelling with a referee and you're ejected? How does it make you feel at the moment you're ejected? And Draymond may respond, I feel gratitude. I feel good about it because he was wrong. I feel at peace because I'm going to stand on what I want to stand on. There's something there with feeling good about being ejected 2 minutes into the game and you guys are fighting for the playoffs. There's more than just him trying to make his point heard well enough, he's going to stand on it to be ejected.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things happening behind the scenes that, you know, he knows.
May have to be addressed.
He sat down with people and they're working on those things. Now, he's using self-talk. And this has been going on his whole career.
Right.
That's why I say self-talk only can go so far. And that working with different levels of the subconscious mind and being able to tap in to the person at that level to introduce change at a relaxed state, rewire the neural pathways in the brain. This is scientific, folks. This is nothing that I'm making up. This is all scientifically proven. And you can rewire the neural pathways in the brain and create new realities for yourself, new learning patterns and new behavior patterns. And I don't know if Draymond is working with a hypnotherapist, a sports hypnotherapist, But I know that it would help him. But I can tell you that if he's not, and he's continuing to do this while he's working with a sports psychologist, it's because he hadn't set his intentions. He doesn't want to. He don't believe in that SHIT. He don't want to. And when you cannot, I mean, you cannot use these type of holistic practices on people, coaches won't use them if they haven't set their intentions and their belief system doesn't align with a new technique or strategy to use with players.
Like, so it's funny you said that, right? Because you're talking about coaches setting the atmosphere for this, for people, for organizations to make this an acceptable practice. I think along the lines of Phil Jackson, right? They used to think Phil Jackson was weird, a weirdo, because he kind of had this kind of, I don't know, kind of the same type of sin that he always used to call it. And when you just said that, that made me think of him. And look how successful Phil was with the Lakers and the Bulls. And also, I don't know if it went back to, I'm a Knicks fan, so I don't know if that went back to his glory days as being a role player with the Knicks. But your thoughts on, you know, somebody like Phil, you know, making these guys, not making these guys, but introducing them to, hey, there's another way to skin the cat, so to speak, or to beat an opponent, and that's to just be mentally tough.
Well, I'm just like you were back in the day. Everybody thought Phil was the Zen master, and we was like, man, Phil got them boys reading books. Phil is working on the mind. We didn't really know what that meant.
No.
Now I do.
Yes.
Phil was working on the mind, so to speak. You know, he was showing them from a cerebral aspect of control and accessing skills, or accessing this next level of performance by simply being within yourself. And Kobe and Shaq and all those guys, they'll talk about it in different interviews on how they were meditating. And Kobe was too. Kobe was more in tune to his ability and to his next level. This Mamba mentality, I would say that it all came from Phil Jackson and the books he would give them to read, in the ways he would challenge their mindset, in, you know, the rotations he would put together just to see what they were going to do and to see if he could affect them in any kind of way for the good, for good or worse, and then rebuild them. And when you think about it, Phil was big on breathing. He was big on meditation. He was big on, you know, just being in tune with the self. And when you're in tune with the self, there's focus. Tom Brady, how many fourth quarter comebacks does he have? Because he's out on the football field, he's in tune with the coach. He's in tune with the self. When the play comes in, it's just total focus. It's not because he was born with it, and I'm pretty sure some of it was. It's because Tom Brady works with a mindset coach. Tom Brady works with probably one of the best in the world to helping him focus on the moment. And what does the moment look like for you? And when you're in the moment, what do you see? What do you feel?
Right.
Now, let's slow that down for a second. And in that split second, I want you to breathe. And I want you to process. And I want you to remember. And this is consistently over and over and over, using, and I'm not sure what the strategies his coach was using, but I would use mindset training. I would use hypnosis training. I would use affirmations. At certain moments, I will find the right receiver. I know that 3rd and 10, if they give me a box set and they're playing too deep, I will go to my second receiver in the boundary. Is these are affirmations that he's saying over and over and over and over until they become what, guys? Muscle memory. Why don't we work on things that help us be better and perform at a higher level by making it muscle memory. We do that in golf. We do that in football. We do that in baseball. We know that we get in the ball. We twitching our hips because we've practiced it so much. But the mind is a muscle.
Yeah.
Mind can recreate if we train it to. And that's what I'm trying to introduce to a number of people. And there are a lot of, there's some sports hypnotherapists out there that probably speak the same way I do. And sports psychologists probably speak the way they do. But, you know, coming from us is pretty rare. And
yeah, I'll tell you, what you, just
you know,
said,
just
Jason, so, what you just said, man, you say it slows down and breathe. Like every great athlete I've ever heard says, in these moments,
it slows down.
The game gets slow. And the game's not getting slow. It's slow because their mind is processing quicker than the actual game. Like they're seeing it faster. But for them, it's like, this is slow. I know I'm gonna look this guy off, pump. I'm going to turn, the safety's going to be over there, and I'm going to throw it over there. And you can see it before it happens because you train yourself to breathe in chaos. You know, you can breathe in chaos. You can
breathe in chaos.
When everybody else is going mad, you're like, wow! You know, you're like, yeah, this is my jam right here.
I mean, performing in the midst of anxiety, you know, how can I do it? Because you've trained yourself to do it. It's almost like being in football practice when you're in high school and you're going through the 2-minute drill. And, you know, the coach is like, okay, no, I mean, you're going. You're training for the 2-minute drill. You know exactly what play to call, where to go with the ball. You're training for that. And if we could simultaneously have, you know, if the resources were there for the young men to have that type of training from a mental aspect, oh, man. You know, it'd be hard for teams to beat each other because everybody would be such on a cerebral level that, you know, it would be astonishing. It would be amazing.
A super soldier, as I attested to the other day. Let me another personal note. Now you got me thinking, bro. Okay. I remember being in a Babe Ruth league. I play baseball and football in high school, but I remember distinctly a coach told me one time before, and I was playing right field. And he says, Kevin, you got to want every ball that comes to you. Because sometimes I would be like, man, I don't want nothing to come out here to me. You know, you're in right field. You know, baseball is a little bit slower than football, of course. And when he told me that, like, a light bulb just came on to me. And I wanted every ball and to come to me. And I became a better right fielder, which meant they moved me to center field. And in high school, they moved me also to center field. Played center field, right, and third. And I wanted every ball to come to me. So much sometimes the coach would be like, hey, man, you can't overstep the shortstop. He's got it. You got to let him feel it, man. But even back then, and I'm pretty sure the coach had no idea what he was doing, but what he told me in that instance, hey, you got to want the ball and not be afraid of it. And that has even carried on into my personal life. Him telling me that. I'll never forget that.
He gave you an affirmation. I mean, something that you said to yourself over and over and over again, Kevin, until it became a muscle memory, until you made it a part of who you are. Maybe he only had to say it to you one time, because some kids are able to intake this information because their world is cluttered with a lot of other things. Where am I going to eat? Is my mama or my daddy beating my mama when I get home?
True.
Do I have to wear the same clothes tomorrow that I've been wearing for the last 2 weeks? You know, am I going to have somewhere to sleep? So
you're right.
You know what I mean? So you were able to, when it came in, you were able to grab it and it resonated with you know, what you wanted. And so him telling you that was just a simple affirmation. For you to live by, and that's why you've taken it with you in your life. Some people just they're not able to receive this information because they don't give a crap. They hear the coach, but they don't hear him. But there's always a reason, DA, on why they can't hear or why they can't see.
Let me get to this next question, man. This is good. This is good. Hey, you explore. We're gonna talk about visualization and imagery extensively in chapter 4. You talked in your book.
Yeah.
How can athletes effectively use these techniques to enhance their performances? And are there any common mistakes they should avoid?
They can effectively use visual. An athlete can effectively use visualization in a number of ways. Listen, the first way is while they are training. Okay. You know, before you take the next rep, young men and young women out there, visualize the rep while you're in line. Know what exactly you need to do. Replay it over and over in your head so that it becomes like clockwork. It becomes a part of your memory. Visualization is just like dreaming. You know, just you're in a state, you're in a focused theta state. And as a matter of fact, you are practicing in the theta brainwave state. Athletes train in the theta brainwave state and they play the sport at a high speed doing competition in theta brainwave state, the state of focus, the state of concentration. So while you are in practice, visualize the next rep. Now, some people may say, it's just hard for me to visualize. You can remember your last birthday party. You can remember when you got the first kiss from that girl.
Right.
You know, the young girls can remember when they got their first purse. You can right. see it. You can visualize it. The second way you can use visualization that coaches can use it is while they're watching film or while they are directly, you know, communicating to the athlete. You know, tell the athlete exactly what you expect and then use the technique on the athlete. Now, before you get in, visualize you making the play or you receiving the call, receiving information in your responsibility, just like we watched on film. So you can use this, even if you do it over and over and over in the meeting setting with the players. Making them visualize, making it a part of the way you coach, then you'll have players sitting in the room, athletes sitting in the meeting room, listening to everything you say, watching film and visualizing themselves actually enacting the play or actually making the right decision right there. You can also use visualization while you are at home. You know, while you are cooking, you know, constantly thinking about what to do next. You can visualize a car. Now, visualization is huge when you're manifesting. Yes. It is huge when you're trying to bring something in your life. Just like we talked about Billy Carson, his visualization techniques are very, very, I mean, they are cutting edge and he learned them from someone else. However, Billy Carson always says when you're manifesting a car, you can't just manifest, I just want a new car. No, what kind of car? Well, I want it to be a Corvette. Now visualize the color of the Corvette. Visualize the kind of rims you want. Visualize sitting in the car. And visualize the kind of radios in the car, in the carpet. So visualization has to be a vivid description of what it is you want, along with the manifestation. And we can call the manifestation along with watching the film, visualizing exactly what you're supposed to do in great detail. And if you're visualizing just, you know, okay, I'm running, I'm making a play, I caught the ball, then you're not doing a good enough job with visualization.
Right.
You know, and, you know, outside of that, what was the last part of your question?
Hold on one second.
Before you get there, Kev, I was going to say, that goes back to what you said last week about those goals and being able to really be specific about what you want and how you want it. So it's just not a general, I won't be good. What the hell does that mean? You know, what does that mean?
Yeah. And DA, also visualization can also be looked at as self-hypnosis. And self-hypnosis is you being able to move yourself into a trance-like state and being able to take this journey. Let's just say you're sailing, you know, on a river and you're and you have a picnic basket and your girl is out there, you're playing music, and this relaxing journey you're taking, and then all of a sudden you start to, you know, you sit there and you guys are talking and you start to say, you know, she said, what do you want to be good at? What are your goals? I want to be the first player in my college to hit, I mean, to have a triple double, 15 triple doubles. And the way I want to do it, I want to do it rebounding. I want to do it with block shots, and I want to do it with steals, you know, a double double. That level of visualization, that when you're doing a self-hypnosis session while you're at home, you're visualizing this nice moment, this relaxing moment, and you talking to someone, and now you are saying what you want, how you want it, when you want it. This is all subconsciously you're doing this in the self-hypnosis session. But in order to even do self-hypnosis, which that's a thing, it's not me making it up, you have to be great at visualizing, you know. So the subconscious mind, when, you know, like hypnosis works directly on the athlete's subconscious mind, and it attacks the habits, the seat of the problems, the belief system, and the behaviors of the person. So those are the things you're working against. You're trying to solve, you know, habits, habit stacking. I know we're talking about visualization, but a part of helping these guys and trying to steer them, these young ladies, steer their athletic performance in the right directions, is because they have bad habits. And I'm going to tell you guys one thing you can use, one technique that I like. It's called habit stacking. Okay, let's just talk about habit stacking. Well, you wake up in the morning, the first thing you do, let's just say DA gets up in the morning, the first thing he does before he does anything, he'll get up, go in the kitchen, and get a glass of water or get a bottle of water. That's just one of the first things. Before he even goes to the bathroom, I go get me a bottle of water. Okay, then the second thing you do, whatever bad habit you have, you put it right there on top of this good habit. And then what's the third habit is, once I get me a drink of water, because I wake up with a dry mouth, I immediately go to the bathroom. But you stack this bad habit in between. And that bad habit may be that every time the pitcher throws a curveball, you don't track the ball well enough.
Right.
So after you've taken a drink of water, then you say to yourself three times, I need to track the ball all the way to the mitt. I have to track the ball all the way to the mitt. Then you go use the bathroom. So you've stacked, you've executed a good habit, and then you stacked it with a bad habit that you immediately, it triggers you because you're habit stacking. It triggers you to address it, then go to the bathroom. We call that habit stacking. So you could obviously, you can switch it around and, you know, but you stack good habits. You stack a good habit, then you put the bad habit, and you stack it with a good habit. And that's a technique I use also to get players to change, you know, and move from bad habits. People move from bad habits to good habits. And that approach can lead to, you know, rapid changes in performance and, you know, a number of things that you're trying to do in your personal life as well.
Gotcha. I think I said in the, yeah, that's a lot.
That's good. That one is good, man.
Yeah.
Never heard that one. Habit stacking. That's good.
And then, you know, Google it, look it up, guys, when we get off, and you'll be like, oh, okay, this is what Jason was talking about. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to absolutely Google that. Let me go ahead to this next question here. It says, in the final chapter of your book, it focuses on team building and communication. In your view, what are the most critical elements of creating a cohesive team environment, and how can mental training techniques be applied to improve team dynamics and communication? And I believe this can be used also in organizations, not just as sports also. So have at it, Jason. I know you got a great answer for this one.
Creating a safe place. Creating a place in the team's mind that's safe, you know, preaching that there's no dumb question, there's no you know, nothing that we can't get through as a team, giving these young men the ability to come talk to you, the ability to talk with amongst themselves about problems they're having, you know, allowing the players to, you know, be able to express themselves, you know, and also coaches being approachable, you know, building this environment that, you know, we're all in it together. But I would just say the first thing is to create a safe place, a safe space. And that's just in the workforce in general. You want a great team at the at work, then you have to introduce practices where people are open to have time. Maybe they want to do some small meditation work, or maybe people want to kind of spend more time within themselves. Offering small breaks where people can, hey, you want to go outside, get a breath of air. You know, when you have a number of young people, first off, they have to feel like you care about them. They have to feel like it's not just all X's and O's. And one example is, I had a guy on one of my shows yesterday. And, you know, he said that when he's coaching these guys, he talks to them, you know, hey, how are you doing? How's your mom? How's your dad? How's everything else going with you? Good. How are you? Not a lot of coach. Tell me how you doing. I'm doing good, coach. You know, any problems you having in your life? Not really. You know, my girlfriend acting up. What's going on with that? You know, you don't have to tell me if you don't want to. Coach is asking because I want to make sure you're okay. And I also heard, and Deion Sanders does a, people be ragging Deion, but Deion Sanders, that's one of the biggest thing that he does. He makes it okay to care about yourself and to care about the players and teaching the players how to care about each other by using gratitude techniques. And gratitude is always being thankful of things that are around you. Deion Sanders uses a number of mindfulness techniques with his players to build team camaraderie. He tells them that he loves them regularly. He tells them that I'm going to make you a man. He tells them that, hey, we have to be better in the classroom. So there are just a lot of techniques you can do for team building. And team building also starts with telling everybody that we have to build a level of respect for each other. And this respect comes from showing gratitude to the next person. A lot of guys have grown up doggy dog, you know, and they just don't have that mentality. But when you are loved and you show a stray dog love, eventually that stray dog is going to stop barking and being vicious because he can feel the love. Right. And again, we're not talking about softening up coaches. We're just talking about how coaches can effectively introduce the smallest things to show this young man from Florida, where it's a number of dogs in Florida. But these guys grow up tough in Florida now. New York, Chicago, Texas. These guys, some of these guys are coming from homes that don't have a lot of love. They don't have a lot of positivity, but they can play some basketball. They can play some football. When you foster this culture of gratitude, you foster this culture of mindfulness, and you create a safe place in the work environment, then you create an employee that's much more efficient, an employee that's much more happier, because there are things going on outside of the job. There are things going on outside in the player's life, in that when they do come to school or when they do come to the complex, if it's safe and if it's an environment of love, it only builds the team and it only builds the uniqueness of your program. And I think UConn has that. I think Iowa definitely has that. And, you know, when you look at LSU, you can tell that that's sort of a safe environment. But Kim Mulkey, you know, she's rough on what she thinks a person should be like, on what what they like. Kim Mulkey is like, nah, I need to be this way. That's not so much of a safe place. I think the players make it a safe environment because they have each other's back. But her history is well documented 100%. With Brittany Griner on what right. she thinks should be. And that's not creating a safe place for the athletes, therefore damaging the fabric of team building.
Yeah, I can see that. I can see that. Yeah,
that's she's a little
different.
I want to ask you, Jason, this before we get out of here. Who is what athlete, if you had it your way, who would you want to work with if they would allow you to work with them? If you had somebody and I to be a client today,
who would you want? It's two guys, Ja Morant and it's Dak Prescott. And Ja Morant, it would be because there's a lot of, and I don't know what he's doing. I know that when he went and half a time away from the NBA, and he was then, working with counselors, and he was doing whatever. And then he came back, and then it was just some of the things that he would write on Twitter, and some of the actions with the video, and people were like, "Oh, what Ja's doing? What is he doing now?" You can just kind of tell that he went and had some talk therapy. And maybe he just thought it was the best thing for him to do. But I think that it goes deeper than Ja. I think it's more dealing with moving into the depths of his subconscious. And I think it's more dealing with, how he grew up and the ways that he attaches himself to different things that he may idolize or different ways that he think he should be
acting,
and it's almost as if there's some type of past life trauma that's just there that is not being dealt with. So I would want to work with Ja and just show him the powers of hypnosis and the powers of sports hypnosis and how it can really affect his mind at the subconscious level. And then it would be Dak, and you and I, we talked about Dak.
Yeah. But let me ask you a question, Jason. And I know we're getting to the end of this, but let me ask you a question about that, because that leads me to a commissioner league, all leagues. So do you believe that it's counterproductive for a league to mandate that a Ja Morant goes to talk to someone when their actions or clearly saying that he doesn't necessarily, and I'm not talking about him, I'm just using that name as an example, or player A clearly doesn't believe that, he has a problem or whatever it is, but because the league sends you to see someone, then there's an expectation, right? Because you're never disappointed if there's no expectations. So people are expecting something because, hey, they sent Ja to go see Jason. But Ja went in there to go see you, because he was getting paid to go see you, He said, you can just tell by looking at him in your conversations, because you have a script once you get the information in that they tell you what's going on. And you can tell by then, okay, this guy is jerking my chain. He really doesn't want to be here. Something maybe more serious has to happen for him to understand it or whatever it is. Is that counterproductive for the athlete to keep sending someone somewhere when they may, based upon the way that they're acting, they clearly don't believe that they need to be there?
Well, DA, we talked about a player. We talked about Kevin sending his son somewhere. You need to go see Jason. But if he's not ready, if he don't want to, it will never work. I don't care if it's talk therapy or if it's hypnosis. It won't work. But let's just say at the NBA level, at the multi-billion dollar level business, they are getting a lot of scrutiny for not being mindful, so to speak, of the player's mental health.
So it has to happen.
It has to happen from a visual standpoint, from the way they're being perceived. The things you're doing go directly against the player conduct code. And since you keep violating the code, we're wanting you to go see someone and talk to someone, because we cannot be insensitive to your mental health. So, but then Ja wasn't all the way bought in. He didn't believe in any of that nonsense. You could see what happened. The the incident after incident after incident where he was actually acting out. There's some pain there. There's some blockages there, some trauma there, and that he probably doesn't even know about and doesn't even realize why. And the parents may say, well, he grew up in a middle-aged household. He's never been like this. We've raised him true. Again, this is where it gets into some people, you know, consider woo-woo. It could be a different past life. It could be something that you would need to use regression therapy, hypnosis regression therapy, where you regress people. I don't talk about this a lot because people are like, well, what is that? It's supposed hypnosis. Just lay back and let me work on you. But, you can't, you know, pitch that to a team. I want to use this technique. Well, but there could be things that aren't happening in this current lifetime that can be reached through certain techniques, holistic techniques that can highlight and find when did it start. So in that case, you know, with Ja, it's just the NBA has to save face. And they have to look like they're trying to help this young man with his mental illness or purported mental issues. And at least they're saying that we're going to send him somewhere to at least have talk therapy, but it's not working because you have to have set your intentions. This is something that I want. This is something that I need. Now, I think that in some ways he's realized, you know what? Let me just straighten up. Let me just clean this thing up. But has he bought in totally? I don't know. But I would like to work with him because I think I can affect him at the subconscious level, at the deepest levels of his mind. And I believe I can change some of the neural pathways, some of the thinking, some of the negative beliefs that may be still there, and some of the negative talk that he may still hold on to from, you know, what he's perceiving from the outside world coming right at him, and teach him how to be more mindful and how to flatline what the world is saying. It's more like a LeBron. Oh, LeBron is mentally freaking tough. You talking about mental toughness? You know how many people talk about this man, ridicule this man? I mean, he has so many haters out there, but his mental toughness is something to be, just to marvel. And Tom Brady's mental toughness is something to marvel. Kobe's mental toughness is something to marvel. But can we actually say outside of the football field, I'm sorry, outside of the basketball floor, that Ja Morant is mentally tough? No, he's not. He's succumbing to pressures out there that he's allowing to affect his personal life and his job. So anybody that's allowing something to affect their job and their personal life, how mentally tough are you outside of the job that you do? We know his mental toughness in the game and no one can hold him and I'm going for your throat. Yeah, there's some infiltration in the mind that leaves him vulnerable when it comes to other things in his life. And I think that's where I can affect the subconscious mind. And helping him move from that space, move from a fixed mindset, because what I see is a fixed mindset. A mindset is just kind of stagnant, and it's right there thinking this, thinking that. When he needs to develop more of a growth mindset, you know, that's open. And we talked about this the first session. That's open to different things. That's open to different techniques to become more efficient, to become more clear. But yeah, and then we talked about that, and there's just something that happens with him at the highest level of competition. He has a level of anxiety that kicks in that
It's weird, man.
And that can only be affected at the subconscious level. That can be changed. But, you know, again, you know, when Jason, you have a lot of people around you that's in your ear, you don't hear.
But he had 5,000 yards every year, 20 touchdowns, 4 interceptions, and get to 2 minutes left and forget to call a timeout. You're like, oh, come on, man. Come on, somebody.
Yeah. You know, Kevin, at that moment, Dak Prescott, he always seems to not be able to mentally take that next step. It's not his physical ability, Kevin. It's his mental capacity at these high-end moments where he needs to perform. He's not able to do it.
Jason, I got two other questions for you. And I don't know if you can, we might have to do have you back on again. we was talking about athletes. And I'm think I'm gonna ask for the rest of the guys that's on here, on the podcast here. We absolutely rip apart Ben Simmons, who's currently playing for the Nets. If you was to work with Ben Simmons, or what would you prescribe for him? What's going on with him? Is it an act? I don't know. I don't know what to think sometimes, man. And I don't want to say that, you know, somebody's faking some kind of mental health. So I will hope not. But in your professional opinion, what do you think is going on with Ben Simmons?
I think Ben Simmons is suffering from mental illness. And I think that he has to have constant work. He needs to wake up happy. He needs to go about his day feeling good about himself. He needs to get to practice, and no matter how tough it is, you know, it's a great day for me. Ben Simmons is the type of athlete that needs to constantly work on the techniques that are given to him by his therapist constantly every day. Ben Simmons is also, in my opinion, the type of guy that has seen success. I'm gonna skip this week. I feel good. And then all of a sudden he's had four good days and then two bad days in his room, locked with the door locked, crying profusely and don't know why. This is what happened to people that have the mental illness. So they have to treat mental illness and the techniques that they're given for their mental illness. They have to use it every single day. It's a part of their life. I would affect Ben Simmons. I would use quantum healing hypnosis. We've been talking about sports hypnosis this entire time, moving to the theta brainwave state, but I will use a technique called QHHT, which is quantum healing hypnosis, which not only moves you to the theta brainwave state, the deep theta, but it moves you into the somnambulistic state. In that state, I can regress him into different past lives. I could then find the answers from his own higher self. And you know, a lot of athletes may say, what is he talking about? But if you go read about quantum healing hypnosis, Dolores Cannon perfected this technique. It is one of the deepest forms of hypnosis you can use. We can regress people to different childhood. And they do that with regular clinical hypnosis now. But quantum hypnosis moves you past the childhood, past into a different lifetime. And it may not be this current life where he's having all these problems. It could be another lifetime that he's having all these problems. And if we find out which one it is, we can then bring it forth and then start to speak to the higher self. And I know I've mentioned this before, but I don't actively use the technique unless I need to for certain athletes who are really, really, really struggling with situations. I can also use it to heal, you know, because, you know, we talked about this the first time. If you cut your hand and if you just let it be, and don't use Neosporin, the hand is going to heal. Well, why? Because there are cells that are rushing to the area and releasing antibodies. But who's telling the cells to do it? Well, the brain. Well, who's operating the brain? Because our consciousness is not local. Our consciousness is being beamed in from a higher place, from Christ consciousness. And our consciousness is not localized. We're all working on one frame. So that means that the higher self is directing the brain to heal. So if we can get to the higher self in quantum healing hypnosis, moving to the deepest states of the mind, and then start directing the higher self and asking questions of the issue, if we can bring it forth. Now, the only way Ben Simmons can be brought back to himself is that he self-reflects and self-realizes, yeah, I want to do this. Yeah, I want to move to that, to the deeper states, because I am tired of this. I'm tired of this up, down, up, down. And we talked about players having to self-realize, and parents and coaches and whatever can't force anybody to do anything that they don't want to do. But if he wants to, and he says enough is enough, then that's the technique I will use to really go deep within his subconscious. And I've written about this time and time again, and I know it's foreign, Kev, DA, to people out there, but there are techniques that we may look at as woo-woo. And I said before, I've been in the sports business, representing players as a player, big time universities, Suns playing right now. I'm not just talking about things just because I've watched a few videos. I'm certified in a lot of these modalities and they work, but that's what I would do for Ben.
Wow. That's a lot, because we absolutely talk about Ben Simmons.
I got to get to Brooklyn and get Ben your number.
Because, you know, a lot of people equate money with happiness and stuff like that. And like, man, what's wrong with this guy? How can he be unhappy and he getting $30 million a year? And you just broke it down on why.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's one of those deals where, you know, he's in a situation where it doesn't matter about the money. It just matters about the way he's processing information. You know how he perceives when a person says something to him. Where does that move him to? You know, a teammate tells him, "Man, stop fouling in practice." Well, that could be someone saying, "I'm gonna beat you if you do that again," and he's afraid of that. We just don't know the triggers that he's dealing with, and we don't know the demons that people that are suffering with mental illness. It's a terrible thing to have post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, and that's a mental illness. It's a terrible thing to be depressed. That's a mental illness. And depression is, man, I wouldn't wish it on anybody, but I was serious when I said that sometimes you can have 3 or 4 great days, and 2 days you're in your room crying. I work with clients with depression, crying all day long and don't know why.
Why?
Don't have a clue why, but can't drag yourself to even get up and use the freaking bathroom or get a glass of water because you are so sad. And you contemplate all kind of things. But this is deep subconscious mind work. I think that talk therapy plays a part. But all these things, you hear me say them in different situations, are really used for the same thing. You can move it into business to help a executive learn how to build team morale. You can move it to a baseball manager to get his team to play harder just by using different mindfulness techniques, different strategies on team building. You can use it in a relationship with your wife. Just, you know, showing her gratitude and, you know, thanking her for all the little things she does, the small things. And if you do it long enough, she starts to perceive you differently. And mental illness, man, is building a person up and trying to find out how they feel about every little thing that affects them. But I like to take it a step further. I like to move and delve deeper into the subconscious mind and use past life regression therapy to figure out where did it start? When did it start? Can we remove this? You know, and you have to get buy-in from the actual person, you know, which we're talking about, Ben.
Yeah, you said it best about all the people. If you want to get better, so to speak, you got to buy into this. And you know, with more information, you get more understanding, get more wisdom. And I just think this has been a great, 2 hours and change that we have talked. And I'm glad we connected, Jason. I really am. And, you know, allow our listeners to, you know, and I said it, you know, we're the Sports Chasers for a reason. And we want to encompass and cover everything when it comes to sports. And the mind is definitely has everything to do with sports. One last question. This is a fun question because we've kind of went down the mental health thing, and that's kind of gray and dark sometimes, and depression. Yeah. And it's real. It's real. It's real. But we're going to end on a happy note. on a happy note. And I ask my guests, our guests, this all the time. So with this said, Jason, who would you want if you had within your power to be a guest on the Sports Chasers that you have within your power to have on the show?
Man, Michael Jordan, because that the way his mind is, and to hear him talk about resilience, and to have Jordan talk about, you know, my thumb was hurting, but I figured out a way to, you know, get back out there and do it. Well, how'd you do it, Mike? You know, my mind is stronger than everybody else's. You know, I was raised different. Just Jordan's his approach to his mentality, his resiliency, his toughness. It would have to be Jordan. It just would have to be. But the second, yeah, it would be LeBron. You said who would? It would be Jordan. LeBron is right here, but it would be Jordan, because just his mind, his sports mind, and the way the mindset, his mind works around mindset. Yeah, it would be him.
Okay, I got you. That's all right. DA, you got anything before we get on out of here, bro?
Once again, brother, thank you. You know, we're going to continue to get together. I'm going to see maybe we get some of our fans to, like, you know, get some questions together. We can send to Jason and do this another time, and he can just answer some of the fan questions. You know,
absolutely. Yeah, I mean, you guys need those kind of questions answered, you know, get back with me. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. And I got my little cousin just became a big time football coach up there in New Jersey football. You know, they're trying to come on strong, and I think this will take him. His relationship with the kids on the team, it's a public school, I think will definitely help to kind of combat some of those recruiting things that they do in high school football up there, where they just pay for you to come, you know, big Jason, you're going to come live up here and, you know, stay in this house, and, you know, you're going to play football here.
Give them a gas card. That's what they do in Texas. Give them a gas card, get their mama a job.
Yes, sir. So, yeah, I'm with you now.
All right.
That's what's up, man. Listen, we had fun doing this, man. Mm-hmm. Jason, thank you again. Let me give you some I had my applause up there. I did have some applause. Where's the applause there? Yeah, let me go. This has been really good, man. Thank you so much, Jason, for coming through. And like I said, we will do this again. Like DA said, we get some questions together, and thank you again, man. Any last things before we get on out of here?
I just want the athlete to trust yourself to explore different things, to create different opportunities for yourself so that you can reach the optimal level. And I like you guys to relax. You know, anytime you're trying something new, just relax. Just listen to instruction, you know. And, you know, if someone wants you to visualize some things, relax and do it. Relax when you're under pressure. Relax when you don't get to play as much. Then the last thing I want guys to understand and ladies to understand is discover. Discover new things that are around you. Discover who you are. Discover the inner workings of yourself. Spend time with yourself. Spend 10 minutes a day in quietness and discover what it feels to sit there in quiet and in peace. Trust, relax, and discover. Thank you guys for having me.
I'll do all that. I love that.
Well said. Listen, we're going to get on out of here. I don't have myself. I'm Kevin O'Warren of the, as you can see, we got a new sign up here of the Sports Chasers podcast. Be good. Be blessed. Hey, we'll see you on the other side. Y'all be good. Peace.
That's a wrap for today's episode of the Sports Chasers podcast. Don't forget to subscribe on YouTube and your favorite podcast platforms, and connect with us on all social media channels for exclusive content and updates. We'd also love for you to join the conversation, share your thoughts, and become part of the Sports Chasers community. And remember to tune in next time for some more real sports talk. Until then, stay frosty.